This is Geometry Unit 10, Lesson 7, the rest of the notes on rhombi and squares. Okay, so from what we've watched previously, there are three ways to prove that a quadrilateral is a rhombus. So you can prove it is a quadrilateral is a rhombus if it is equilateral. If you can prove all four sides are congruent, then you can say it's a rhombus. You can also say it's a rhombus if you can prove it's a parallelogram with two congruent consecutive sides. So if you have a parallelogram and you have consecutive sides congruent, that would be sides next to each other. Well, if it's a parallelogram, the opposite sides are also congruent, so that works as well. So if you can prove that just two consecutive sides are congruent, if you have a parallelogram, you can say it's a rhombus. Okay, and the third way is to prove it's a parallelogram with perpendicular diagonals. Okay, if you have a parallelogram with perpendicular diagonals, it's a rhombus. So if you can prove that you have a parallelogram and then the diagonals are perpendicular, then you can say it's a rhombus. So this one is actually the most common way of proving it, either if all sides are congruent or that it's a parallelogram with perpendicular diagonals is usually the easiest way to do it. Okay, so let's look at an actual way of proving this. So this is a coordinate geometry proof. So we have quadrilateral rhom, R-H-O-M, has these vertices, and prove using coordinate geometry that rhom is a rhombus. Okay, so there are lots of ways we could do this. So if we wanted to prove it's equilateral, what formula would we have to use? We'd have to use the distance formula. I don't really want to do that. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to prove it's a parallelogram. All right, so we have five ways of proving a parallelogram. Let's use slope. Okay, so let's find the slope of the four sides. So the slope of, we have, let's do HR first. All right, if I look at the slope of HR here, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, -1/7. And then I have the slope of the opposite side, which would be OM, down 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, is also -1/7. Okay, what does that tell me? That tells me HR is parallel to OM because they have the same slope. Okay, so I know this side is parallel to this side. All right, now let's look at the other two sides. Let's do the slope of HO. All right, the slope of HO would be down 1/1, looks like, down 1/1, going down. So it's going to be -1. All right, so down here, over here. So it's going to be -1. And then the slope of RM is also going to be -1, down 1/1, down 1/1. So that means that HO is parallel to RM because they have the same slope. Okay, so we've just proved that both pairs of opposite sides are parallel. So what does that mean? That means that this is a parallelogram. So that means rhom is a parallelogram. Okay, now I want to prove that the diagonals are perpendicular. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to draw my diagonals. All right, so here's my diagonal drawer. I'm going to draw in from H to M, and then I'm going to draw in from R to O. So we have our two diagonals, all right, and now we want to know if the diagonals are perpendicular. What do we have to know about the diagonals? We have to know their slope. All right, so we want to know the slope of HM. Okay, so if we count HM here, it's down 1/2, down 1/2. So the slope of HM is going to be -1/2. And we want to find the slope of OR is going to be up 1/2/1, up 2/1. All right, so what does that tell us about HM and OR? What do you notice about those slopes? HM is perpendicular to OR because they have what kind of slopes? They have opposite reciprocal slopes. So that means that a parallelogram with perpendicular diagonals is a rhombus. Look at that. We have just proved that this is a rhombus. So if you use perpendicular diagonals, you have to prove it's a parallelogram. I used opposite sides are parallel. You could have also done opposite sides are congruent, one pair of opposite sides congruent and parallel. Or you could even prove the diagonals bisect each other by finding the midpoint is the same for both of them. It would have worked for both ways. Okay, so now that we know about quadrilaterals, or rhombi, I do want to go back to a previous one and add something else when I do this. All right, so let's look at this picture right here. We already found the values of x, y, and z. You can do this at the bottom of your paper. So what I want to do is I want to borrow this picture right here for a second. So let me grab my snip here. Let me do it this way. And I'm going to snip, oops, I just goofed that up. Yeah, undo. Let's try that again. All right, never mind. Okay, so what I wanted to do was I wanted to pay attention to about the diagonals of a rhombus, and them being perpendicular. All right, so let me draw a quick rhombus here. All right, now the diagonals of a rhombus are perpendicular. They also bisect each other, do they not? Yes, they do, because this is a parallelogram. So let's say if we have ABCD here, and let's say that AC is 10. What does that make AE and EC? Well, that would make them 5. Okay, and let's say that BD is equal to 12. Well, that means that each of the pieces, all right, well, let's use 14 because I know something's going to work out. Let's see, 24. Let's use 24. Okay, so let's say BD is 24. So that's going to make these two pieces here 12 and 12. Okay, so that means that if I wanted to find the perimeter of ABCD, I'd have to know the sides. All right, so now if this is a right angle right here, isn't this a right triangle? Couldn't I find BC by using Pythagorean theorem? Yeah, so I can find X to use Pythagorean theorem. So that means that 5 squared plus 12 squared will equal BC squared. This question shows up a lot. That's why I'm including that. So this is 25 and 144 gives me 169 equals BC squared. And then take the square root of both sides. So BC is going to equal 13. So that means this side is going to be 13. So not only do the diagonals bisect each other, and since they're perpendicular, you're going to have four right angles there, making four congruent right triangles. So you can use the Pythagorean theorem to find any part of that. So the perimeter of ABCD will be 13 times 4, which is going to be 52. Okay, so that's what I want to tell you about a rhombus. Let's move down to the last part, which is about the square. Okay, so the last part is about the square. From the investigation that we did, a square is a quadrilateral with four congruent sides and angles. Okay, so that means it is equilateral, because all the sides are congruent, and also equiangular. All the angles are congruent. Okay, so equilateral and equiangular. I love that word, equiangular. Okay, so first of all, that means the square has a lot of properties. It's a parallelogram because the opposite sides are congruent. That works nicely. We did that in the investigation. Okay, it has right angles, so that makes it a rectangle. Opposite sides are congruent, it has a right angle, it makes it a rectangle. And it is, since it's equilateral parallelogram, that means it's also going to be a rhombus. Or equilateral quadrilateral, I should say. It's going to be a rhombus. So all of the properties of a square are all the properties of a parallelogram, a rectangle, and a rhombus. Okay, it's going to have opposite sides congruent, opposite angles congruent, consecutive angles supplementary, and the diagonals bisect each other. And a rectangle, it's going to have congruent diagonals and all right angles. And a rhombus, it has congruent diagonals, or excuse me, this has perpendicular diagonals, and the diagonals bisect the angles as well. So any property that we have for a parallelogram, rectangle, or rhombus will apply for a square. Okay, so that's all I have about rhombi and squares. So this is the end of your lesson.